Hello, this is Apostle Keith Barr, and my program, The Voice of Revival, is coming up next. Hello, this is Apostle Keith Barr. You're listening to the Voice of Revival broadcast. We want you to stay tuned for the next hour. We're going to be bringing you the Word of God, some exciting testimonies, and we're going to be praising and worshiping God, and we're going to be praying for everyone that needs a miracle here today. So we want you to get on the phone and call someone and tell them to tune in, amen, to this station right now, because God has a blessing for them. God bless you. This is Apostle Keith Barr. You're listening to the Voice of Revival. Get ready for it. Praise God. A great blessing. God has a blessing for you today in this broadcast. And I believe you will hear some things that will change your life. Praise God. God is here. He wants to bless. He wants to bless his people. Jesus said, "With his two or three gathered together in my name, there I would be in the midst." Let's go to God and pray. Heavenly Father, as we come before you right now in the name of Jesus, I ask, Lord, that you would bless and anoint this broadcast and cause it to be a blessing to each and every hearer. Let your people be touched today and let their lives be forever changed. Yes, Lord, and let your perfect will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. And I want to also remind you that as we are on this broadcast, that we're also doing a live Periscope broadcast. And today we're going to be talking about effective prayer. Effective prayer. Praise God. We're going to be talking about, first of all, we're going to talk about some things that hinder prayer. Now, why do we pray? Because we need, well, one thing, God commanded us to pray. And we need God to move for us supernaturally. There's a number of reasons for prayer. Number one, we pray because he commanded us to. Amen. He commanded us to be full of the Spirit. The Bible says if you walk in the Spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. And so I found that to be so very true in my life, that as long as I prayed, that I was strong. Strong in my mind, strong in spirit. You know, fearful people will make you afraid. And as you pray, the Holy Spirit will strengthen you and encourage you. We need to pray, amen, so that we have the right frame of mind. We need to pray, praise God, so spiritually we'll be in the place that God wants us to be in. Now, the Bible tells us that we know not what we should pray for as we ought. And many people, I mean, although everybody in the world can pray, there's certain keys, amen, that we need to follow. And that's, praise God, we just got a follower from Puerto Vallarta. I was in Mexico for 16 weeks last year, and in many cities in Puerto, many cities in Mexico. And good afternoon. I'm saying good afternoon to those that are coming on. And I want you to encourage your friends to come on, invite your friends, your followers on this broadcast. And thank you. We appreciate all these good well wishes. Thank God for the saints coming on the Periscope broadcast. And some of you on the radio, I can't see what we're doing on the radio, but we want you on the radio to invite your friends. We're going to talk about prayer today, effective prayer. And so people all over the world are praying, but not everyone has results. Praise God. And I want to tell you there's a way that you can have some great results when you pray. And there's a word, like I say, there's a world full of people praying, but many people don't know how to pray. They don't know, you know, the keys to effective prayer. And you know, I could not begin to tell you how many prayers of mine I have seen God answer. And There's so many. I've seen miracles. I've seen God turn things around. God's blessing, prayers of protection, prayers for direction. I know that prayer works. If I was to convince you of how prayer works, I'm sure I don't remember all the miracles that I've seen. I know I don't remember all the miracles that I've seen God perform. But it would take me. I can't even imagine how many days or years if I just talk without stop. And the more you talk, the more, you know, more things come back to you. I've seen God do some amazing things, some amazing miracles, some miracles of finances, miracles of putting homes back together, miracle of changing people's minds, miracles of divine protection, and so many things. So, you know, if it's we need to know how to pray. And we need to have effective prayer. Now, there's been, somebody might say, well, there's been studies on prayer that prayer really doesn't make a difference. Well, I said, well, that depends on who's praying. And there was a recent study on prayer. University of Indiana, I believe it was, did a study on prayer, personal prayer. And they found out, see, a lot of the things people that have done studies on prayer, they had unbelievers praying. They had people praying that wasn't even Christians. And people that didn't believe, but just praying. And so sometimes when you listen for a poll or something like that, you have to check and see who did the poll. What was the questions, that they asked? Did they skew the poll to make it... to make it sound bad, to get the results that they wanted, and people can and that's sometimes you have to watch, even with your medical studies. It was found out that the main medical study that everybody did, for instance, about high blood pressure, that a guy tested and he did the results. He tested with mice, but we found out later he gave the mice 30 times the daily amount of salt. So, you know, you give anybody 30 times the amount, you're going to have these terrible results. And so a lot of people that are on high blood pressure, I mean, you know, well, only 30% of the population is even, salt has any effect upon them. Only 30%. So 60% of the people that are doing all these not taking salt and stuff, trying to reduce their salt, it has no effect upon them. It's only 30%. But like I say, this study was skewed to get the results that this doctor wanted. And a lot of them do that. And so that's why you have to look at things and get into the polls and check. And so this is what has always been done with studies on prayer. If you want to know how effective prayer is, you have to get people to know how to pray. You have to get people of faith. You have to get people that walk with God. Praise God. They can tell you a story after story about how God preserved them and made a way for them. I remember one time I was talking to my wife's grandmother, Big Mama, we used to call her. She's going on to be with the Lord. And it was during the Depression, and they were praying. She was a young girl, and they were all praying for God to send them some food. There was no, they're down in Tennessee, and there was no food nowhere. And they were so praying God to somehow send them some food so they wouldn't starve to death. Like I say, this is the Great Depression when people were really starving. And so she had a dream that this particular night. She had a dream that she saw this field and this tree, and God directed her in this dream where to go. And there was a field where there was a lot of beans. And lightning hit a tree in the midst of this field of beans, and the leaves fell on the field and covered a portion from this tree that was struck by lightning, and the leaves covered the beans. And then time passes. They were watching. In this dream, she's watching, and the field dried up from the drought. But underneath the leaves of the tree, the beans were still safe. So when she woke up that morning, she went to follow the directions of the dream. She didn't even know where this was at. And as she followed how the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of God directed her in this dream, and she came to this field and she saw the tree with the limb on the ground had been broken from the lightning strike. And she pulled the leaves back. And just like the Lord had showed her in the dream, there were beans. The rest of the field was burnt up, but the beans where it was covered by all these leaves from that tree. Even though the leaves had dried up, they had protected the beans underneath. And so she gathered them all up in her apron, a big pot of, she had a big apron and gathered them all up under that and took them home. And that meal saved their lives. And so they were praying literally for food and God to direct them. And God showed them in a dream where to go. And so if you could talk to some of these old mothers, they could tell you, and some of these old prayer warriors, yes, how God answered their prayer. And so this study, you can look it up, University of, I can't remember if it's University of Indianapolis, or University of Indiana, or Indiana State University, on personal intercessory prayer. And so they followed some people to Mozambique, and where they said, you know, the most effective prayer was when people were actually touched and laid hands, as the Bible commands us to do, to lay hands upon the sick. And so they went to Mozambique, where they were having a revival and a conference there. And they measured the blind people and the deaf people, because that's what you can, you know, measure. You can't measure back pain. You can't measure, you know, many other things, but they can measure blindness and deafness. And they charted everyone. And then they went before prayer, and, you know, not everyone received, many of them received total healing, but there was some that received partial healing, but it was instantly after prayer. And this is all, it is a university study. So prayer does work. We have scientific evidence that prayer works. Hallelujah. Let me say it again. Prayer works. Now we pray for a number of things. We pray, amen, so we be full of the Spirit, so we won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. If you don't pray, you will fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now, sometimes it's hard to pray, especially when you haven't conditioned yourself in your mind and your spirit to pray. It's easy to pray when the Spirit of God is upon you strong. But so many times you pray, you won't feel the Spirit of God. That's why Bible tells us, first of all, start praising God, enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and our courts with praise. Amen. When the first part of praise, when you come to God for prayer, it's praise. That was in Psalms 100, enter his gates with thanksgiving, to his courts with praise, I believe it is. And Jesus, when the disciples asked Jesus to teach them to pray, he gave them the Lord's Prayer. He says, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so the first part of the prayer is praise. Praise and submission to God. If you want to pray, first of all, you must get somebody's attention. You must get God's attention. And you get his attention by coming to him, praying for him, and worshiping him. God demands praise. Hallelujah. Praise God. He's got to be God in your life. He's got to be first. He's got to be preeminent. And so you can pray and God will answer your prayers. But it's important for us to pray. We pray because we need help. We pray because we need direction. We pray because God can do anything. He can do anything, and he knows what you don't know. And he can bless you in ways that you never imagined. Praise God. He can bless you financially. He can bless you. Praise God. Give you witty inventions, things to help you, to make money, to change your life and circumstances. Praise God. Hallelujah. And he'll do these things. He wants to prosper you. God wants to make you happy. He wants to praise God. The Bible says, delight yourself also in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Praise God. Hallelujah. God will give you the desires of your heart first if your heart's desire is to please him. So let me list a couple things that can hinder prayer. And one of the things that can hinder your prayer, I'm going to give you four things that can hinder prayer. First one is doubt and unbelief. Doubt and unbelief. Bible says in James 1 and 6, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavers like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. So first, praise God, you must have faith when you pray. Bible says, he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So the more faith that you have, the more your prayers will be answered. And so, praise God. Make sure, amen, that you have faith. Build up your faith. And some many times the devil will try to talk you out of your blessings. And so, but you have to think about what the Word of God says, what God promised you. And don't look at the evil report. Don't look at things that the devil is telling you. I remember one time I was ministering in a service in Flint, Michigan. And the Lord told me, he said, now tonight I want you to stay in the back until it's time for you to preach. Tell them to do the service announcement, all that. And you stay in the back. I don't want you to see the congregation, nothing, until it's time for you to preach. So I said, okay, Lord. So I was in the back praying. And as I was praying, well, finally they came and got me. And so as soon as I came out on the platform, this one woman, she just lit up. Sometimes, you know, we minister in the word of knowledge and we call people out. And it was like a flashlight was under her skin. And her whole body just lit up. And that's how I knew to call her out. And then the Lord spoke to me. He said, call her out. I'm going to touch her. And so I called her down and I said, come here, sister. Come here. I want to pray for you. And she was maybe 20 feet away from me. And when I said that, she said, ah. Oh. I looked, I said, what is her malfunction? I said, you know, Lord, she don't want prayer. How is she going to receive anything? She don't want prayer. But that wasn't the case. The case was she could barely walk. And she struggled to get to her feet. And she walked and she trembled as she walked. It's like she was on the planet Jupiter or something with 2.5 times the gravity that she could barely lift her legs. And she trembled as she walked. And I started to walk towards her. And the Lord said, no, stay here and let everyone see how she can't walk. And so by the time she got to me, she was in so much pain. I had never seen anybody like this. I'd seen crippled, but you could either walk or not walk. And I'm saying, you know, so when she came to me, I was literally horrified. And I said, sister, what's wrong with you? And she began to tell me about all the pains and things she had. And she said, actually, this was a good day. And so she said that many times they help her to a chair in the living room and she just can't move. And people come to her door. And she, even though she's a few feet away, she can't even get up. And she was like a prisoner in her own body. She just cried. And she started listing things that was wrong with her. And it's like she was reading a medical journal that she just listed so many things that was wrong with her. And I said, as the more she talked, I'm looking at her and I'm listening to her, my faith diminishes. Now I'm at a point, and then she told me one of the things, I don't remember, the only thing I remember is that She said she had a plastic kneecap. That's when a lot of her trouble started. And like I said, she had listed a long list of things that was wrong with her. And as I'm standing there, the devil began to talk to me. And he said, and he actually said these words, "Boy, you done got yourself in a mess. What can you do with a plastic kneecap? God does not heal plastic kneecaps." He said, "You got yourself in a mess, but this is how you get out of it. You start talking about gradual healing, and you just, pray for her, don't make no big deal about it, and send her to her seat." And God hadn't said nothing else. And I'm standing there, and people are crying, feeling sorry for this woman, and they're looking at me. Now what you gonna do? What's gonna happen next? And the Lord hasn't said anything. I'm doubting because I'm looking at the evil report. And not that she was evil, but I'm looking at the sickness of her body and how she's trembling, could barely stand. But then I remember what the Lord said. The Lord said, "Call her down because I'm going to touch her." See, because it only takes one touch from the master to receive a miracle, a touch from God. Hallelujah. And so I laid hands upon her, and I said, "Lord, I ask in that name which is above every other name, touch this woman right now from her head to her feet. I don't know all what's wrong with her. Lord, you heard her describe many things, and I'm sure the doctors don't know, but heal right now." The woman began to shake and tremble. The Holy Ghost came upon her. Praise God. Hallelujah. And before our eyes, she lost about 25 pounds. Her clothes was loose. And she said, "Look at me. Look at me." She said, as she began to lift her legs and lift her eyes, "I can move. I can move." And she started rejoicing, and she fell on me crying. And there wasn't a dry eye in the place. She was so happy. She fell on me crying. Praise God. And so, see, at the verge of your miracle, Satan will come and try to steal the miracle away from you and make you doubt. So, see, you got to trust what God's word says. And if God has spoken to you, you got to claim his word. Hallelujah. God gave me a great miracle almost a year ago. I was dying of heart failure and pneumonia. I had to believe God and confess. By his stripes, I was healed. And let me tell you, the first 10 times I said that, nothing happened. And I may have said it 100 times. I know I said it 100 times. I was saying it throughout the day. I said it thousands of times. By his stripes, I am healed. I had to claim my healing every day in the midst of my weakness, in the midst of my what I was going through. Praise God. Hallelujah. But God totally healed me because I didn't waver. James 1 and 6, "But let him ask in faith, nothing wavereth, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed." Praise God. Prayer is the greatest weapon that God has given us, that we can ask him. He said, "Nothing shall be impossible unto you." So if you so, but many everybody can pray, but people don't know how to pray. People, they ask, but they don't ask in faith, and they don't know how to build up their faith. Praise God. Your faith is like a treasure that you should protect. You should protect. Praise God. I'm getting tickled because I was thinking of one time I was watching a TV show with Bill O'Reilly and Glenn Beck, and Black Beck was a salesman for all this gold, putting your money in gold. And so Bill O'Reilly said, "How much gold you got stored in your house?" And this is on national TV. And O'Reilly got scared. I mean, Beck got scared. "Why would you say there's gold in my house? There's no gold in my house." because you can't let criminals know, and I don't know if he has any or not, but he did. It was just funny. But if you have much treasure in your house, you want to protect your treasure. And hallelujah. And so this is more valuable. Your faith is more valuable than gold. Yes, your faith is more valuable than gold. Protect your faith. Protect when you need a miracle. Praise God. Time may come. You may need a miracle of your healing. You may need a God to give you divine protection. Hallelujah. And what good is gold and silver if you're going to lose your life? And so, praise God. Your faith is more valuable than gold. So you need to protect your faith. Build up your faith. Hold fast to your faith. Believe what God said. Believe what God spoke to you. Believe God's promises for you. Thank you, Jesus. And so the one of the things that can hinder your prayers is doubt and unbelief. Now, why is that? I have a theory on it. No one knows for sure how doubt can hinder God. Many times, sometimes people came to Jesus and said, "Lord, can you heal me? If you want to, you can heal me." And he said, his reply to them was always, "If you can believe." Now, why does God need you to believe so much if he can control, which he can, everything in the universe, and he can reverse anything, you know, whether a person says, don't matter whether you believe hell is real or not, if you don't live holy, if you're not saved, you're not washing the blood, you're going to hell. If you haven't received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're going to hell. I don't care if you're a nice Buddhist, if you're a nice Muslim, if you're a nice Christian, that's not enough. You must be saved and washed in the blood of Jesus. And yes, that's right. Somebody wrote, doubt turns off the manifestation. Yes, it will. And so you've got to be obedient, and you got to believe. You got to believe God. So I believe that doubt is an insult to God. I believe that when you doubt, you're asking God for healing, and you doubt, you're doubting his goodness, you're doubting his mercy, you're doubting his word. And, well, why should doubt matter? Because sometimes the Holy Spirit, and the Bible says God is a spirit, they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So our spirits have to be connected to his spirit, just like a cell phone has to be connected to a cell tower. And I believe that many times healing is manifested through our spirit. So if we have unbelief, it can block the healing. Praise God. Hallelujah. So number one, like I say, doubt and unbelief is one of the, two of the strongest things that can hinder your prayers. Number two, strife with your spouse. Yes, strife with your spouse. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them, talking about their wives, according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. So if you have strife, and I believe this is especially for the men, if you have strife with your spouse, and your prayers can be hindered, because God wants you to be an example of his love and his blessing. And if you treat your wife wrong, it affects her, it affects the children, it affects your testimony and everything. So God's not pleased if you mistreat your wife. To God, one of the worst things in the world is someone that don't provide for his own. The Bible says he's worse than an infidel. So you got to take care of your own. You got to take care of your own house. Amen. Because to God, that's worse than an unbeliever. And he said, if you offend one of these little ones, my little ones, it's better for you to take a millstone about your neck and cast yourself into the sea. Now, a millstone is a huge, thick stone that they would use to grind up the meal. Many cities would have one. They had a public place where people would come, and they would just roll this giant wheel about 6 feet round and crush the weight of it. It would crush it was like a big donut. It would crush the meal underneath. And so this thing would weigh tons. And so Jesus said, it's better for you to take that and tie it around your neck and cast yourself into the sea than offend my little children. So your prayers, can be hindered by strife with your spouse. God wants you to dwell peaceably with your wife and peaceably with your husband. And these things can hinder your prayers. Unforgiveness is number three. Unforgiveness will hinder your prayers. In Mark 11 and 25, and when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive your trespasses. Verse 26, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive your trespasses. So if you want your prayers answered, you got to be right with God. So you can't have unforgiveness. Amen. You got to get the unforgiveness out of your heart for God to answer your prayers. Hallelujah. And so number four, disobedience can hinder your lack of prayers. Disobedience. We'll take a scripture from 2 Chronicles 24 and 20. The priest is talking. Thus saith God, why transgress ye the commandment of the Lord that you cannot prosper? Because you have forsaken the Lord, he hath also forsaken you. So God has given us commandments. He's given us commandments that he wants us to follow. And we follow these commandments, we will be blessed. Don't let the devil trick you to have an unforgiveness against anybody. I have a saying, I said, somebody's got a problem with me. I don't let that affect my heart or feeling towards them. They have a problem with me, that's their problem. It's not going to be my problem. The Bible says, if you have an ought against your brother, amen, go and leave your gift at the altar and go and be reconciled to your brother. And so these are some things that can hinder prayer. Praise God. So we need to make sure that we are not disobedient, that we're not walking in unforgiveness, because we want our prayers answered. We want our prayers answered. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to give you some keys for effective prayer. Some keys for effective prayer. And so those that's following on Periscope, we thank God for you. If you like what's going on, give me some hearts. Invite some of your friends to come on. Amen. If you want your prayers answered. Now, God can answer your prayer financially. God, for your prayers for finances, he can answer. I know one brother, he was praying. He was a roofer. And he was praying for God to help him, to give him something that would be a financial blessing. And he was praying, and then the Lord told him to go to his garage, and he went to his garage. And the Lord told him to take these different ingredients and mix them together. And that he had in there his roofing stuff and material. And he mixed it together. And then after he finished, it was this black like tar substance. And he said, Lord, what is he? The Lord told him, said, take it outside. In your driveway. And he had a hole in the driveway. And the Lord said, pour it in the hole. And so he poured it in the hole. He said, okay, Lord. He said, Lord, what is this? The Lord said, it's a miracle pothole filler that I have just given you. And he filled the hole up, and then in 20 minutes it was dry. And he had found out that this was better than anything that we currently had. God gave him a secret formula for a pothole filler. Many states are using it, and in different cities and counties. And the nice thing about it is it's permanent. You know, it's liquid, so it's permanent. So more water does not get in there, and it's stronger than regular asphalt. And so it's so good that some cities, even though they've been approached with it, don't want it, because the union people have their jobs out every year filling the potholes up. So if you start putting, and many of them in the same spot all the time, they fill the hole again and again and again. And so they don't want to have a permanent pothole. But I wish they would, because, Michigan, boy, and these states, it's cold and it's hot. these potholes. I was listening about on the news the other day about people having flats and stuff and hitting these potholes. But here the Lord gave this brother a business idea, witty invention, something that nobody had ever seen. And it's pothole filler, so it's being sold all around the country. And so God can give you something that can be a financial blessing unto you. Praise God. Hallelujah. You need to pray the Jabez prayer. Lord, oh, the devil, bless me indeed, Lord. I want you to really, really bless me. Thank you, Jesus. And so he said, ask that you may receive and that you shall receive. And that's why he wants us to ask so that you can receive, not no therapy, not feeling better just because you pray. But he said, ask that you may receive. Why? That your joy will be full. Praise God. Now, somebody said, I don't care about spiritual things. I mean, carnal things. I just care about spiritual things. You lying. Amen. You don't want to be naked. You don't want to be cold, and you don't want to be hungry, and you want to have a place to live. So God created us, and he's put things in this world to meet our needs. He wants your needs met. He wants you to ask so that you may receive, that your joy will be full. A lot of people preach against the prosperity gospel and say it don't work. Well, it don't work for disobedient unbelievers. Hallelujah. God wants to meet you at the point of your need. And if you increase your faith, you will see more miracles. You will see more blessings. Hallelujah. So, number one, glory to God. I just feel a witness in my spirit. God wants to give somebody a miracle here. Glory to God. So, number one, ask so that you may receive. Matthew 21, verse 22, and all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive them. Number two, ask.
Violent weekend in Chicago has left 11 people dead and 60 wounded in shootings across the city.
A local 18-year-old was shot and killed by police.
So that's
family members joined by protesters are demanding.
Someone has to come to the rescue. No tights,
nothing
no dress shoes. Scars hurt for the earth, no rest in a cesspool.
Death is away from you, but don't let him do it.
You choose this only because the calling arrests you.
Romans 8:26, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. You don't even know what you should be praying for. You don't even know. But he'll show you what you should be praying for. Get in the Spirit. Pray in tongues. Praise God. If you don't have the gift of the Spirit to pray in tongues, ask God to give it to you. And so, because when you're praying in tongues, the Holy Spirit is praying through you. And it'll give you what to say. Glory to God. But you need to pray according to his will. Because God answered all prayers according to his will. Ephesians 1 and 11, whom we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. Praise God. And so sometimes, number five, pray a prevailing prayer. Sometimes you have to get determined and about a specific thing and pray till you pray through, till you feel a release in your spirit. Till you feel a release in your spirit. Pray till you pray through. Glory to God. And so Daniel prayed till he prayed through. And God sent Gabriel to give him the message. Jesus prayed in the garden till he prayed through, till he had the victory on the way to the cross. Because before he prayed through, he said, Lord, if it be possible, let this bitter cup pass from me. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So you got to pray till you pray through. You know, it's a lost art today with many saints. They don't understand the value of spiritual things. Now, glory to God. They don't understand about praying through. Being patient. Praying till you get anointed. You know, people tell me, oh, you're so anointed. You have so many miracles. Yeah, because I pray so hard. I pray hours upon hours a day that I may be anointed. See, I call anointed holy radiation. And the more you in God's presence, then the more anointed you will be. So you need to pray for God to anoint you. Praise God. You need to pray for the Spirit of God to be upon you. Preachers, you need to pray that people get blessed when they come near you, when they come around you. Pray for a greater anointing. Praise God. That you have, and the anointing will do most of the work. Glory to God. If you're anointed, oh, sometimes all you need to do is just say a word. Sometimes just lift your hands if you're really, really anointed. And the anointing, the Spirit of God will move. The Spirit of God will flow. Praise God. And so anointing is holy radiation. And so the more you are in his presence and labor for him and to ask for things, ask for more of him, the more anointed you will be. Praise God. Now, people come in my services all the time that are sick, and they've been praying for a miracle. But then when I lay hands upon them, many times I just touch. Hallelujah. And they're healed. Many of my services, you know, I know a lot of people have back trouble, knee trouble, and I'll call them down first. And many times, and I'll line up 15, 20 people with back trouble, knee trouble, and go through and pray for them and touch them. And some of them are supposed to have operations to be able to continue. Their knees have deteriorated or back has deteriorated so bad. And I can just go through and just touch, bam, 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 bam. You know, just walk down the line. And then I come back and ask them, how do you feel? And usually 100% of the people are instantly healed. And glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. So see, the more time you spend in prayer, the more God will show you what is available for you, what is possible through you, what he can do through you, the more time you spend in prayer. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The more time you spend in prayer, God will tell you what to do and prepare your heart and your will to do it. God wants to greatly, greatly, greatly bless you. Glory to God. Praise God. Wouldn't you like to be so anointed that people that come around you, they're blessed? That people, I remember one time in my service, I was ministering. I was going among the altar, and we had a visitor that day. And they were all at the altar. And the Lord told me to go touch this young man. And I obeyed and just went and touched him. But what I didn't know is he had a dispute with his brother-in-law at the altar. And reason why he was mad at this one brother was at the altar is that his wife had come over there. His wife had come over there to a house, and a couple of sisters got in an argument, and he threatened one of the sisters, got in her face. So she went home and she told her husband. And so he said that whenever he saw him, he was going to jump on him. He was going to, you know, it was going to be a big fight, and he was going to beat him down. And so here he is, he hadn't seen him, and been waiting to see him, looking for him, and he sees him at church, and he sees him at the altar. And so he's ready to jump on him right at the altar, right with the kids around and everything. It would have been terrible. It would have been horrible. And this was, you know, this wasn't going to be a slap. This was going to be a serious beatdown. But the devil was in his ear and striving him and filled his heart with so much anger and hatred that he didn't even care about the kids at the altar and being at the church. It would have been terrible. And he said, but as I'm at the altar and praying for people, I wasn't praying for that many. I just, you know, had them come to the altar. The Lord said, go by and touched him on the shoulder. And he said, when I touched him, glory to God, on the shoulder, all that anger left, just like that. It all went away. He said, can't nobody tell him I'm not a man of God. And so, see, we know not what we should pray for, as we all not thought about, God, my God, suppose I had missed you at that point. You told me to just touch him. But that would have been horrible. It would have been horrible for all of us and the kids. And for him as well, the whole church family had been horrible. Hallelujah. But the power of God, the anointing of God, that's why it pays to be led. That's why it pays to be in God's presence and to be full of his spirit so God can use you. There's people around you, the people that's close to you, that need a touch from God. They need a miracle. You need to pray and get anointed so you can bless people. You need to pray and be anointed so you can touch people. You need to have the Spirit of God. You don't know what people are going through around you. People around you can be in desperate need for you to touch them. An anointed hand, lay anointed hands on someone. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Witness to people. Everywhere you go, you know, Andre Crouch died this last year, and he had beautiful homegoing service, and I listened to it, and portions of it, and so many people testified what a blessing Andre was to them over the years. He's, you know, man, when you think of how many churches and how many people, thousands of people, and his records is playing, I said, God, he must be one of the greatest of all time, not the greatest, of course, you have to say Jesus or some of the others, but in recent times, certainly, as far as blessing people, and because so many people sang his songs, to help get you through. I can't tell you how many times I just sing Through It All and other songs. And so he was just such a blessing. But one of the things I was inspired by about Brother Andre was, they said at the funeral, they said, you cannot come near Andre in a circle without being witnessed to. Said he witnessed to every stewardess, he witnessed to every waitress, anybody that come around him, he said, do you know Jesus? I said, my God, we need that kind of boldness to witness to people and tell them about Jesus. Hallelujah. And so thank God for a man of faith. God wants to use you to bless people. When you allow God to use you, he will bless you. Hallelujah. I hope you're enjoying the message today. But sometimes we got to pray till we pray through. And that's why many churches, you know, we don't have revival. We got some of the greatest tools that's ever been given to the church to reach multitudes. And, you know, so many things, technology, with the word, with TV, with video, with the internet, Periscope, YouTube, Ustream, live stream. Again and again, we have so many things, more so than anybody. Hallelujah. Thank you. Praise God. But we don't use, many of us, we don't use the greatest tool that we have, and that is prayer. And so your church needs prayer warriors. We need people that will pray hours. Every time there's a revival that breaks out, whether you're talking about the Zeus or anything else, it was people that gave themselves their lives to prayer. And to prayer. And as they prayed, God would move abundantly. And so we have to pray that God's will is done here on earth. You have to pray. If you want your family blessed, you want your family saved, you want your family healed, you have to pray for them. And God will do the work. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you for your word today. Praise God. You can bring revival to your city. You know, Charles Finney, one of the great revivalists of all time, that won many cities to the Lord. He used to say, if I could just get one person to pray with me 24 hours, just one person, he said, I can take a whole city. And many times there were such powerful moves, the whole cities got saved. Hallelujah. So, do you need people saved in your city, in your church? Get together, get a prayer team, get some love, get a prayer chain, and go hour after hour praying for revival to sweep over and sweep across your land. Pray for the Spirit of God to come and touch people and touch people's hearts, whether they're in church or out of church. Praise God. They don't have to come to church for God to touch them, but they need to come to church for them to keep what they have. But praise God. Believe God that God will touch your unsaved family members in a way that they could not resist. When I was in Mexico, one of the women I called out during the prayer line, the Lord stopped and let me call her out. And I told her, I said, God has answered your prayers, something you've been praying about for many, many years. God has answered your prayers tonight. And when she got home, her husband, she'd been married to for 38 years. And he never let her pray. Didn't want to hear nothing about God. The spirit of conviction was upon him so strong. And he asked his wife to pray. Hallelujah. He asked his wife to pray for him. And so she said she felt like she was in a lottery. She had won the lottery. She was so happy about she was so happy about it. Glory to God. And she and she ran back to the church to tell us what God had done. She felt like she had won the lottery. Hallelujah. So let's pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for our listeners today, both on radio and on Periscope. And God, we want you to touch each and every one. God, send revival to our cities and to our midst. And God, moved by your spirit, we know that you can draw and you can do things what we can't do. And God, do the work in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, save the unsaved loved ones. Hallelujah. Lord, draw people, new people into the kingdom, into our ministries, into our churches. Save these people and heal right now in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Heal your people. Heal their broken hearts. Heal their minds. Hallelujah. Let your anointing sweep over everyone here today. Let your anointing touch people right now. In Jesus' name. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. Amen. For moving by our spirit. God, moving the land. We need revival. And God, we can have revival when we begin to pray and seek your face. In the name of Jesus, glory to God. God, give us revival. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Lord, stir the hearts. Stir the hearts. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Minister to each and every one. Yes, God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory. Lord, we thank you. Praise God, because through prayer, you turning it. Lord, turn every situation around right now where Satan has tried to stop your people and stop us, bless our blessings. We receive our miracles, Lord, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. So until we see you on next time, God bless you and keep on keeping on. Amen. Hallelujah.
Well, I trust that you have enjoyed this broadcast today. I want to thank you for listening. And I believe by faith that you were blessed by the words and the testimonies that we share today. If you'd like to get in touch with us, you can go to our website, KeithBarrRMinistries.com. That's KEITHBARR Ministries.com or just KeithBarrR.com. And if you like to contact us on Facebook, it's Apostle Keith Barr. And if you like to go to our YouTube channel, we have over 100 videos, miracles of healing from people healed of all types of diseases. These will really be a blessing to you. Go to YouTube and Rev Keith Barr, R-E-V-K-E-I-T-H-B-A-R-R. And also, our email is keith@keithbarr.com. So we trust that you've been blessed. And if you forget all of that or didn't have time to write it, just Google my name, Apostle Keith Barr, and those things will come up. And we also, we like to encourage you to go to Amazon and look at some of our books or our website. We have many books and materials that would be a blessing unto you. So until we see you next time, I just want you to continue to believe God and tune in next week. And remember, if you don't like your situations, if you don't like your circumstance, pray the prayer of faith and God will change it. God bless you.